Today, I'm in conversation with Dr. Gloria Alexander, founder and director of ASHA, which means Action Service and Hope for AIDS. Dr. Alexander is also a co-chair of the 11th National Conference of the AIDS Society of India, or ASICON 2018, being held in Bangalore. Dr. Alexander, you have been involved with the prevention, treatment, care, support of HIV-infected persons with special focus on women and children. Can you tell us something about mother-to-child transmission of HIV, how to prevent it, why is it important to prevent this transmission, and where does India stand on this?
Thank you, Shobha. Yes, I've been working in the field of HIV and AIDS now for little more than two decades. And mother-to-child transmission is very close to my heart. And this is because this is one aspect of HIV/AIDS where you can study the impact of what you're doing. And even if you can have one child that is born to a HIV-positive mother that is born HIV-negative, it makes 100% difference to that one child, because that child can then live a normal, healthy life for the rest of its life. And they are the future citizens of our country. So it's important that we have a healthy India. Mother-to-child transmission accounts for about 5.4 of all HIV transmissions in India. If a mother is HIV positive and she's pregnant, then she has a 25 to 45% chance of transmitting that infection to her child, either during the pregnancy itself, or during labor and delivery, or during breastfeeding. So if you can start the mother on antiretroviral therapy as early in pregnancy as possible, once she's diagnosed HIV positive, and then put her on treatment with three drugs and continue this treatment for the mother throughout her pregnancy, labor, delivery, breastfeeding, and lifelong for the mother, then the baby that is born has less than 5% chance of being HIV positive. And yet the baby gets the benefit of breastfeeding, which is very important in our country. So if the mother is on ART, then the risk of her transmitting through breast milk is almost negligible. So this is very important. And this is the reason why I have so much of interest in this field, because I want those babies to be negative. If a baby is born HIV positive, and you know, before 2004, before ART became so nicely, freely available, before 2004, we had a lot of pregnant mothers who delivered HIV positive babies. And today, those babies have reached adolescence. We have children who are 13, 14, 15, 16 years old, and they do have some issues. We have found that these children are low on self-esteem. They are low on confidence. They are low on adherence, because sometimes they don't know why they're taking the medication, because parents don't want them to do that, want them to know that they're positive. There may be juvenile delinquent behavior. And so they have so many issues. And throughout their life, they have to come see a doctor, be on medicines. And they also grow up in a sense of, you know, secrecy. They've lost a parent, most of them, throughout, during their childhood. And they're wondering what it's all about. Why is it that relatives don't visit their homes? So many issues which come up. And it's very sad to see that these children have to undergo this for something that was completely not their fault.
Yes, for no fault of
theirs. Or, you know, and even no fault of their mothers. Mm-hmm. And so that's a very tragic consequence, poignant actually, of the HIV epidemic in our country. So that is one issue. And this is the reason for my interest in it, because, you know, my first PMTCT baby is now 18 years old. And it's so nice to see them normal, healthy, going to college, leading a normal life, and interested in whatever they're doing. This is not to say that the HIV-positive children are not doing well. They are, but they do have to come to a hospital. They have to take medicines. There's so many other issues. When you look at pediatric HIV infection in our country, 90% of pediatric HIV infection in our country is because of mother-to-child transmission. And the remaining 10% could be because of blood transfusions in children who have bleeding disorders. It could be because of children who have been sexually abused as kids, street children. It could be because of road traffic accidents and they require blood transfusions and things like that. But 90% of these children are actually mother-to-child transmission positive kids. So by eliminating mother-to-child transmission, you're actually eliminating pediatric HIV. So that's the reason for so much of interest. In India, it's a huge challenge because there are 30 million pregnancies occurring in our country every year. And hidden in these 30 million pregnancies are about 22,000, 577 women who are HIV positive. So to identify this number of women, in this huge number of pregnant women, and then put them on treatment is a huge challenge. And with the government, with all its resources that are available, has been able to cover between 52 to 55% of all pregnant mothers. They've done a very good analysis and estimated how many positive women there are in each state. They've done all of that. And I'm sure that, you know, with more effort, this should be possible at some point in time. But right now, it remains a huge challenge.
So, institutional delivery is one thing which you think would help bring in more women for testing, because many deliveries must still be taking place at home.
So, if you look at that, the thing is, out of these 30 million pregnancies, a lot of deliveries happen at home. A lot of women who are pregnant don't even access a health service. If they do access a health service, at least one time they get tested for HIV. But if they don't, then we don't know where they are, where they're delivering, how their child is. Even the mother may not know that she's HIV positive. So that's a huge challenge, to encourage all pregnant mothers to come to an institution for delivery and to have at least, you know, if you have a minimum of at least 3 checkups during your pregnancy, then that's enough for us to be able to identify if the mother is positive or not, and then be able to decide to put her on treatment. So this is very important.
So this is one challenge which you think is there because women are not going to the hospital. What are the other challenges which are preventing India join the league of countries where they have eliminated mother-to-child transmission? Some countries, in rather many countries have, even in Asia.
Yeah, in Asia, Thailand has been able to do that. And then we have Cuba. Cuba, I think they already have a very good primary healthcare system. So this was just a matter of integration and integrating all pregnant mothers and testing them. In India, the challenge is the numbers. 30 million is like the population of a small country. And to identify and get all those mothers to come to a hospital or even to a primary healthcare center where they can be tested, is a challenge. I think that is the biggest challenge. The numbers and the fact that, you know, we are trying our best to ask these mothers to come to an institution for delivery, but how much we can reach out to those mothers. The other thing is that when we look at mother-to-child transmission of HIV, there is a huge cascade of services. First, they have to come to the hospital. Second, you have to take their consent and test them for HIV. Third, you quickly have to explain to them what HIV is about and talk to them about ART. Fourth is that they have to come for follow-up to collect their ART medicine. Fifth is they have to deliver in an institution. Sixth is they have to breastfeed their baby and you have to give the baby medication. Sixth is you have to test the baby at 6 weeks of pregnancy, of delivery. You test the baby at 6 months. You test the baby at 1 year, and then you test the baby at 18 months. And only after you've gone through this whole gamut of services can you say that a baby is HIV negative. And we have this long follow-up for the mother after delivery because the mothers are breastfeeding their babies. So you want to avoid that, you know, you want to be sure that the mothers are not transmitting during that breastfeeding. So you periodically have to test them. So since this is such a long cascade of services, you keep losing the mothers
along these cascade of services. So that's another challenge for us. One are the huge numbers of pregnant women in our country, and the second is losing them along the cascade of services. Many times they give you the wrong TIF mobile numbers, they give you the wrong address. So even if you have a follow-up going on, you go there and you may not find the mother there. So that is another challenge that we have faced. Of course, there were other challenges, like in the medical setting, there were doctors who do not want to deliver women who are HIV positive. And so that was another challenge. Still remains a challenge, but it is better than before. And and once the baby is born, many times, you know, the mother has, the baby and the mother are in the mother's house. The mother's mother's house. And then they have to come back to their husband's house in 3 months after delivery. So when that happens, you lose them. So these are some of the challenges that we face to eliminate mother-to-child transmission.
What would you suggest just to make the entire system more friendly towards the woman? Certain things which we can do which will make her abide by... the challenge means make her more amenable to be part of that and part of that process of elimination and prevention.
Yeah, you know, instead of just isolating the HIV positive mothers, they've kind of provided a lot of incentives for mothers who are pregnant themselves so that they will come for testing. And they say that if you come for institutional delivery, there's a cash incentive. Then there are incentives. Many of the states have this cash incentive. We have it in Tamil Nadu. We have it in Karnataka. So that encourages mother to come to deliver in a hospital. And then also that if you have a child, especially if it's a girl child, then, you know, till the age of 18 years, you can, they'll support her for education and they put money in a bank account and, you know, you can, the interest comes to quite a lot of money at the end of 18 years. So those kind of incentives are there. Then the doctors also should be very sensitive about not discriminating about, against women who are HIV positive. It's very important for them to understand that we're doing the HIV testing to treat the mother and not to send her away, to reject her. So that kind of shift also has to happen. And I think our biggest challenge actually is the numbers. But these kind of incentives may help. The other thing is to, you know, demystify HIV/AIDS and make them understand that it's not a fatal, life-threatening illness anymore. It's a chronic, manageable illness that people can live for years and years with this disease as long as they are under the care of a good doctor. And so at some point, you know, even mobile HIV testing, where you can go out into the villages, it's happening at some places. But demystify HIV/AIDS and say it's okay to be tested, you know, and take it to the people, take it to the community. And there, if you find that they are positive, you can always bring them in to the system.
You must be coming across women who refuse testing. They come for an institutional delivery, but have there been women who say they do not want to be tested?
You know, when we first started this PMTCT program, it was rather extensive. We had to do individual counseling for each mother, each pregnant mother, what we refer to as pre-test counseling, then get her signature for testing, and then do the testing, and then if she's negative, counsel her again. It was becoming a very elaborate process, and I think that contributed to the discrimination. So now we include it along with hemoglobin, VDRL, Hep B, Hep C, HIV. You do all of this. So it's very easy, and you get her consent. It's an oral consent. We don't have to get a written consent. So that has made things easier. And then if you find that the test is positive, then you call her, you counsel her, you explain to her everything, and you put her on treatment. The problem with that is you may miss women who are at risk, because the woman may not tell you that her husband has risky behavior, and therefore she may be at risk. And sometimes you may lose women who are at that kind of risk. But otherwise, that's fine. Very rarely, because you have made it so simple, very rarely do we get women who do not consent for HIV testing. But we have found that when women refuse HIV testing, then there is a reason, and you need to explore that, because possibly the women who refuse testing are at higher risk. And that's why they refuse testing. This is also the case in women who come in labor. They don't come throughout antenatal checkup, but when they are in labor, they come because they know they are HIV positive and they know that the hospital cannot reject them when they've come in labor. So that's the other reason where you must do HIV testing, because even at that point, you can help that mother and that baby. So very rarely have we come across women who are not willing for testing. But when you do find, then you have to be extra careful. And every time they come for a checkup, you must keep asking them, let's do your test, let's do your test. But in a way that's inclusive and not discriminating.
Dr. Alexander, your message for women and mothers and mothers-to-be,
get tested for HIV. It will make all the difference in your life as well as in the life of your child. You must get HIV tested.
Thank you very much. We were in conversation with Dr. Gloria Alexander, who's co-chair of the 11th National Conference of AIDS Society of India. She's also founder and director of ASHA and has been doing human service in the field of preventing mother-to-child transmission of HIV. Thank you.
Thank you.